Hey, welcome to the Gig Life Podcast. I'm your host, Stevie Taylor. This is episode 94. It's Joel Burton. Here we go. My guest today is bass player Joel Burton. Born in Sydney, raised in the far north coast of New South Wales, Joel's first instrument was trumpet before moving to bass guitar at the age of 14. After studying for a Bachelor of Music, Joel moved back down to Sydney. There he worked in music shops, managed a specialty bass store, gigged and gigged, turned pro and hasn't looked back since. Joel plays in the Rayman 3, the Lockie Doley Group, plays tons of corporate and pub gigs with different groups, has his own original project with his friends called Tenderfoot, and he recently finished up season 9 of The Voice as a member of the incredibly talented house band. Joel's a very laid back and humble cat, and with him, it's all about those supporting bass lines, the pocket, the space, and knowing when it's your turn to shine. Clearly, this makes Joel one of the most in-demand bass players around. So, without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, please give it up for Joel Burton. I think we're rolling. Mr. Joel Burton, how do you do, sir?
Bro, how are you?
I'm good, man. Welcome to the Gig Life Podcast.
Man, thanks for having me.
Sweet. We were supposed to be in my studio today. We had it all teed up, but my youngest daughter woke up with a cough this morning, so we thought it best that we take her to get the COVID test done, which we did today. What's especially what I was particularly concerned about was if you came and you got sick and your wife's pregnant.
Yeah.
So that's we thought we'd do the right thing here. But hey, man, here we are on the interwebs.
Here we are
doing it. Now, what I've been starting with the last little while is just asking how COVID has been for you and what you had sort of coming up and what sort of happened during COVID. If you could talk a little bit about that, and then we'll roll back to your early days and lead up through your career and that kind of thing.
Yeah, easy. In terms of what I kind of had, I mean, we started working for The Voice in January. We kind of started, we kind of got together for the first time. So that kind of, that rolled into, I guess, when all this kind of started getting pretty heavy. Then we kind of had a production break that was planned, which was about 3.5 months. So basically we kind of got to a point where everything had kind of come to a stop, and that was only kind of 2 weeks, like 2 weeks before we were due to kind of have a break anyway.
Right.
So that was, I guess that was kind of lucky that we got most of that in, and we ended up going back to they figured out how to proceed with the show.
Yeah.
So we went back 2 weeks earlier, a few months later in July, I think it was.
Mm.
But yeah, in that break, I actually had some overseas stuff planned, some touring, and that obviously didn't happen.
Mm.
As well as just a heap of gigs around town one by one disappeared.
Yeah, are they starting to come back? Sort of, because there are some bands out playing a little bit now, smaller bands, I suppose. Is it? Are you getting on any of that stuff?
I mean, I played a wedding gig on Saturday,
mm-hmm.
Which was funny because no one was allowed to dance. Like, everyone had to stay in their seats.
How does the repertoire go then? How do you sit down and write that set list up?
Well, they wanted all the same stuff, and just, they wanted us to do exactly what we would have normally done.
Right.
But not have a dance floor. So it was a little bit weird, but it was just really nice to kind of get together and play. Yeah, just to see some mates and kind of do that. As far as other stuff, there's been a few little things. It's I haven't really done any other gigs like at bars or anything like that. I've done a couple of live streaming things. We did a thing with Lockie where we kind of got in there and streamed a couple of sets, which was pretty fun. Mm-hmm.
And that was without Jackie because Jackie's stuck in Queensland, eh?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. So he couldn't even get down. So Evan Minnell, who's a monstrous drummer in his own right, like sat in with us and obviously smashed it because he's such a beast. Mm-hmm. But yeah, even just kind of the fact that Jackie wasn't allowed to come to Sydney to even do it. It's funny.
Yeah, it is.
It's not funny. It's horrible.
Yeah, I know what you mean by funny. Yeah. It's just the strange world we're living in right now, eh?
Man, it's strange.
Yeah, and sort of starting to kick off again a little bit in New Zealand. Who knows? Maybe we'll talk a little bit more about COVID a bit later, but, you know. I think everybody's maybe a bit fed up talking about
it. Yeah, it's been, like you say, it's been such a strange time. The thing that I've kind of tried to do is just keep in mind that we probably won't ever have a break like this.
Yep.
Like again. Mm-hmm. So I guess trying to make the most of it and actually get some solid practice in or just do some other stuff. And I guess trying to see a little bit of an upside in the break. Cause like I know that, I mean, since I finished uni, I haven't not had a gig.
Right. I was going to ask how far it kind of went back that, you know, last time you had a break or when did it all sort of start for you, you know, with gig wise. But it sounds like you've been pretty full on.
Yeah. I first started doing some cover. I would have just turned like 18 or maybe I was in year 12 or something like that. And a dude in a local music shop got me to fill in for a covers band and he couldn't do the gig. So I learned all these songs and ended up going out to this pub, far north New South Wales and doing this gig. And it was pretty fun. I don't really remember that much about it. But even when I was at uni, like there was kind of always stuff. Like if you weren't out actually gigging in bars and you were rehearsing and playing with mates and all that kind of stuff. So it's definitely pretty strange.
Mm. We'll talk a little bit more about the uni stuff when we sort of get up to that.
Cool.
All right. Well, let's look a little bit forward to now. Have you got sort of gigs and potential tours kind of sitting there on the knife edge at the moment?
Yeah, I mean, like there's plenty of gigs in the book.
Yep.
Like whether or not they happen is another thing. Like my attitude is kind of like I believe that it's going ahead when I'm standing on the stage.
Yeah, gotcha. That's cool.
Just because everything's so changeable at the moment.
Yep.
It's just a matter of like we'll just kind of see what happens. Mm. There's not really much I guess any of us can do right now in terms of trying to make things, push things forward because there's so much stuff that's out of our control. So like worrying about things that are not able to be influenced by either myself or something I try not to do. I guess we'll see.
Yeah, in regards to how the government's kind of helping out musicians and stuff, I know you're one of the administrators on one of the Facebook groups that we've got at the moment. So you kind of got your nose to the ground a little bit on what's going on. So do you think there's more coming from the government?
It's kind of hard to say. I mean, in terms of what I know, I only know as much as the government releases on their on their websites.
Yep.
It's I don't really have any kind of inside line. So I guess anything that I would say is just conjecture. I mean, they've announced the JobKeeper and the Job Seeker extension thing, which is cool. I think,
but that, is it not a lower rate though?
Yeah, well, that's it. It's a lower rate, and I mean, there's different hoops that people are going to need to jump through to qualify. I haven't really checked out all the details of that yet in terms of how that's going to play out. I'm not even sure that they've released all the details in terms of the requalification yet. So I guess that'll kind of, come to light as it does on that particular stuff. I guess that's not really very specific to any kind of anything specific to the arts though. And there's lots of people that have fallen through the gaps, especially with the way that so many companies operate with, especially in like TV land and stuff like that. They're like short-term contracts for like a season of a show, which might be 6 months. So people would have been booked for years, like camera operators and all the audio guys and all that kind of stuff would have had work booked for at least the next little while, because they often would have like you'd finish one and go straight to another show. But because all that stuff started getting postponed, a lot of those people wouldn't qualify for JobKeeper because they hadn't had a job for 12 months with one particular company, because obviously every show is kind of seen as a short-term contract. So there's a lot of people that kind of fell through the gaps with that, which I would have, and obviously lots of other people would have liked to have seen them included and at least something maybe a little bit specific to our industry that focuses on the people that are making the music or the art instead of the organizations or the touring companies or any of that kind of stuff.
Yep.
Maybe a bit more of like a bottom up approach. So kind of starting with the people that are actually doing it. Like there's no music industry without musicians.
Yep.
But it kind of seems like a lot of the package that was announced by the government for the entertainment industry, which still hasn't actually been, none of the funds have been released, but most of that seems to be targeted at like the bigger organizations in the hope that that money's going to somehow get down the ladder to the people that are actually making the art. But I'm dubious as to how effective that's going to be. So yeah, it'd be cool to see something a little bit more specific and a little bit more like short, like something in the short term that will help people, because people are hurting now. Like even if all that stuff, all that funding goes to touring companies, which or tours for artists to be able to book tours and stuff, that's not going to happen till next year.
Yep.
And that's a long way away in terms of people living between now and then. So yeah, I'd like to see more, but at the same time, grateful that there's at least something, because I know that there's a lot of people in the world that don't have any kind of support, which is pretty frightening to consider as a possibility.
Yeah, for sure. Just going back to The Voice then, like you said, you had that break planned and this kind of happened kind of around the time that break happened. Was there talks there that they wouldn't, that they weren't going to continue?
I guess I'm not any specific conversations that I was privy to. Like we kind of just got told what was happening in terms of, look, we're pulling the production break forward 2 weeks. So, and then the general idea was always that we would go back earlier and kind of pick up where we left off and then kind of finish out the season. And then it was just a matter of, I guess, people like the production company and the producers and everyone had to figure out how to actually run the show.
Yeah.
With all the different restrictions and all that kind of stuff. So yeah, I kind of just always approached it that I'd get told something when there was something to be told. Which ended up happening. We found out about 3 weeks, 4 weeks before the first day we were back in, so we could kind of start prepping for that. And and get an idea of how things are going to run. And yeah.
That's cool. We'll talk a little bit more details and stuff when we get to that. So, all right, man, let's roll it back to how it all began. You were born in Sydney, but you got raised up the sort of the top of the New South Wales coast there.
Yeah. Yeah. So I was born in Sydney, but I think when my parents moved up to a place called Ballina, I would have like one or something like that. So I don't remember anything about being in Sydney then.
Do you know why they moved out of Sydney?
Yeah, it was basically because they were looking at, I mean, it's similar to now, they were looking at buying a house and they were kind of like, look, this is already getting expensive for what they were doing at the time. My mum was not working because I've got an older sister and an older brother she was looking after. And so my dad was the only one working. And he was a printer, so he'd kind of done his trade and it was a pretty solid job, but it was a matter of them kind of looking around and them going, well, we can move up there and actually buy a house and have some space to raise a family instead of renting and all that kind of stuff. So they moved up there and that's as far as my childhood, that's what I remember. It's just growing up in Ballina and then Lennox Head.
Music in the family, mum and dad, brother?
My parents don't play anything at all. My older brother doesn't. My sister was kind of like, she was a singer and we went to the same primary school, so she was in a concert band and everything like that, which probably had a lot to do with me wanting to get involved. Just because you always want to do what your older siblings are doing.
Yeah, right.
And then it was actually only recently that I found out that my great grandmother was a concert pianist.
Right.
I found out like maybe 10 years ago when I was talking to my mum and she told me and I was like, oh, well, cool.
Massive. That's pretty massive.
Especially, I guess around that time, a lot of women weren't really doing things like that. And I think ultimately that's why she didn't keep going with it. She had a family and then there was probably some expectations for her to,
right,
unfortunately, kind of put that to the side and raise a family and all that kind of stuff.
Mm.
But that was interesting to find out.
Yeah. What kind of music was getting played around the house? What was your mum and dad's record collection?
I don't really remember too many specific things. Like I remember my dad always liked a lot of the West Coast, the West Coast Steely Dan and the Doobie Brothers and things like Dire Straits. I remember like Dire Straits and even like Crowded House. Mm-hmm. I'm just thinking of like cassette tapes in my dad's car. And there was always that kind of stuff. So I guess that kind of era of stuff was definitely around and I guess being played when I was at home and stuff like that, and definitely in the car. I've got memories of that.
Yeah. When did it become sort of really prevalent for you, obvious that maybe this music thing might be for me and time to learn an instrument or?
Yeah, well, I guess it did in terms of it getting – getting to that point where I'm like, maybe I actually want to do this with my life. It was probably when I was I would have been like 14 or 15 in high school. But by that stage, I'd already played trumpet in primary school. And when I was in high school, I think my sister was dating a guy and he'd lent her a nylon string acoustic guitar and showed her a few chords, which she showed me. And then I heard Nirvana and just started trying to figure out how to play Nirvana songs on guitar.
Right.
But it was, I guess, when I started maybe taking it a little bit more seriously is when I'd started playing bass, which was when I was 15 or so, 14 or 15. I could do it pretty well. I kind of started getting lessons and And then it just became something that I just didn't really think about doing anything else by the time I'd finished high school.
Yeah. Why trumpet?
Probably, I don't know. I just thought it was cool.
Yeah, cool.
I think all the guys in the all the boys in the primary school either wanted to play trumpet or drums, and I didn't really want to play the drums for some reason.
Yeah.
So I just kind of gravitated towards the trumpet. I was kind of super lucky actually growing up in Ballina, and the local primary school, just the public school, had this incredible band program, like this concert band and stage band program. And they had there was a bandmaster whose name was Mr. Morley, Mac Morley. And he was always so passionate and really kind of about getting all the kids into the band and playing instruments. And there was this other guy who was like he was just a tutor. I think he was an old ex-Navy guy named David Dollery. And he just loved music. He could play every single instrument in the concert band, and he would be there at all the rehearsals and all that kind of stuff, and just kind of helping people out. Or if there was a particular section of the band that needed some help, he'd kind of sit in with them. And then I think he also, if he saw some kids were particularly like had picked things up pretty well, he'd give like you'd stay behind at school. I think it was a Wednesday afternoon. And he'd just give you this really difficult music and teach you how to play it. Mm. So me and a guy who like is still best friend to this day, we both played trumpet, and we both ended up staying back and doing all these extra lessons. And it's just so fortunate that I happened to be able to just access that whole program. Mm.
Learning to read early on too.
Yeah, totally. I forgot how to do that by the time I got to
bass.
Yeah. So it's like I could when I think about the music that we played in that concert band, it's amazing that kids between 10 and 12 could make those sounds. I've got a cassette recording of that band, and it sounds amazing.
Do you remember? What sort of standards were you playing? Do you remember? And do you also remember going away and listening to the originals of those songs, or just learning what your teacher was teaching?
I just remember learning the songs as we had them, and then like as I'd kind of it's funny as I'd grow up and I'd be listening to the radio, a song would come on and I'd be like, why do I know this?
It's a cover.
And it's because
it's a cover of our school band, man. Come,
and it's because and it'd be like you'd play songs like When I'm 64 by the Beatles or Penny Lane.
Yep.
Or even things like Boogie Woogie Bugle Boy. Mm. That was all kind of stage band stuff. And then like as I'd grow up and kind of travel through my musical development, these things had kind of come up and I'd be like, oh, that's what this song is. Of course. And there's like with the concert band, there's lots of soundtrack stuff. Like I think we did the Lion King and probably Phantom of the Opera and some stuff like that, and then some other songs that I don't even know what they were from.
Mm. So once primary school ended, you started high school. What were you kind of doing in between that time of, finishing playing trumpet and before you picked up the bass and started again? What kind of filled that? And how much time were you talking about there? How many years?
Well, I stopped. So in year six, I finished trumpet. So I would have been 12 when I finished in primary school.
Yep.
Then I went to a high school that wasn't in Ballina. It was actually in Lismore. And which ended up being another kind of stroke of luck. But they had a concert band, and I remember going to the concert band rehearsal and they just weren't very good. And I just kind of sat into the first rehearsal. I was like, oh, this sounds really bad. I don't want to do this.
Yep.
So I just kind of told the teacher I didn't want to do it and I wasn't interested. And then I think in year eight, so I would have been turning 14 that year, music was an elective that we could take. So I was doing that again. And at the same time, kind of like I said earlier, my sister had kind of, there was a guitar at our house and I'd kind of learned how to play, I think at E minor and a G.
Right.
So I kind of knew the easy way to play About a Girl by Nirvana. So I thought that was pretty cool.
Right.
And then I just was able to start like listening to things on tape and figuring them out.
Mm.
And then you'd go to like the local news agent and kind of look at the ultimate guitar book and if there was a transcription,
pull
kind of
out.
Like try and remember it and then go home and practice.
All right. No mobile phones, can't snap those pictures, eh?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And those books were like $10. That's a lot of money for a thing.
That's right. That's right.
Go on.
No, you go. You can go.
I was just gonna say I was playing guitar then and I had an electric guitar and I had a band with some schoolmates and we used to hang out and write songs and rock out and all that kind of stuff. I guess I was always playing music. It was just not the same thing.
Okay.
Obviously the concert band stuff and then just making up shit with my mates in year 7 and year 8. And then as far as starting playing bass, same deal. I was in music class and I just finished, like the class had just finished and I was sitting there just strumming a guitar and one of the other music teachers walked in and was talking to my music teacher. And then after that, he kind of came up and said, oh, that sounds cool. What are you playing? And then that was kind of it. Then the next day I saw him at like lunchtime or something and he told me to tuck my shirt in or put my socks up or something like that. And I did that. And then he's like, oh, and do you know how to play bass? And I'm like, I don't know what you mean. Like, I've never played a bass in my life. And then he's like, all right, come with me. And so we went to one of the music rooms and he handed me the bass and he's like, all right, do this. And it was just like, play the E string. And he's like, all right, now do it with both fingers in like a shuffle, like did it. And like, I could do that. And then he kind of asked me to do something else and I could kind of just do it.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, cool, you're the bass player in the school stage band. And I'm like, God, what do you mean? what does that mean? And he just said, well, rehearsals are Wednesday lunchtime. And I think it's in sport, like in like Tuesday afternoon or something like that. And that was kind of the start of me playing bass because this music teacher told me that I was a bass player.
I like this end to the conversation though. Hey boy, tuck your shirt in, by the way. He couldn't have just come up and say, hey, how you doing, man? You want to join the band?
It's funny, like I'm still in touch with that teacher. He's cool. A huge part of the reason that I do what I do today. His name's Nick Peterson. And I ended up, like, he ended up being my teacher all through high school and I learned so much about music and so much of the joy that he had with teaching music and that just rubbed off on all the kids that he taught. I was super lucky. Same as the primary school thing, I was just super lucky to be in that position to have him tell me to tuck my shirt.
Good one. Now, did you go away straight away and start looking up bass players, looking for bass players, and instead of looking at the guitar magazine, going to find the bass magazine? And
it took me probably 6 months or so, I reckon.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe 6 months to 6 or 9 months where I'd kind of still tell people I played bass in the stage band, but I was a guitarist.
Okay.
Right. Yeah, I was still a guitarist, and I that's what I did. I didn't own a bass.
Okay.
So I just would come in and play the one at the school, and if I needed to learn songs, I would just learn them at school. And then after about 6 months or so, I can't remember how it kind of happened, but it was like, all right, cool. Well, I better get some lessons. I'm going to get some lessons and maybe do this thing, and saved up some money and my parents lent me some money and I ended up buying a bass, and that was kind of the start of it. And from then, which would have been, I was 15, like 14 or 15. I was in year nine. So, yeah, I was 14 at the start of year nine. I was a bass player then. And then it was kind of like my teacher started exposing me to some different stuff, and I'd start like listening for bass lines and playing bass lines. And
right.
Yeah, and then I ended up like being in like bands with mates playing bass, mm-hmm. And that kind of stuff. So I guess by that stage it was like, cool, this is what I'm going to do now.
Mm. When you were playing guitar, did you start really learning what all the chords were that you were playing, or was it just like playing the shapes? What I'm kind of getting to there is like when you started taking your bass lessons, did things kind of make sense from the point of view of a structure of a chord or a scale or something like that? Or was
yeah,
it just,
a little,
just
yeah. a little bit, but most of the stuff that I was doing on guitar was just like, I learned how to play some bar chords and some open yep. chords and,
okay.
and it was a way, like I'd go away. I know how to make a major bar chord or a minor one.
Yep.
Yeah. In terms of the actual construction of chords, I had no idea.
Mm-hmm.
I knew how to play like lots of different chords. I didn't know why they were that particular way.
Mm-hmm.
I'd kind of just teach myself stuff from books and yep. song books and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
But when I started playing bass and getting actual lessons, the teacher that I had was very, very thorough in terms of really kind of hammering all that kind of stuff home and starting at the start and learning about like a major triad and all that kind of stuff.
Who were some of the bass players you started listening to early on?
In terms of actual like specific bass players, I guess when I was in high school, a lot of the stuff that I was listening to was like, was stuff that my bass teacher would kind of put me onto. So mm-hmm. even like he was a huge fan of Dig. Like Directions in Groove, that Sydney
yeah,
band.
Yeah, with yeah, yeah, yeah,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
Alex Hewitson,
yeah,
on bass. Yeah, yeah.
Alex Hewitson and and Sam, I think Sam Dixon was in it earlier as well.
Okay.
So yeah, he kind of got me onto that stuff, and so we'd play some of that stuff, and a lot of the time, a lot of that was because at school you'd have to do like a performance every 6 months.
Yep.
So you'd kind of figure stuff out, like songs to learn for that. There's the Red Hot Chili Peppers stuff, which was always like what most kid bass players get into. Who else? I guess, I mean, most of that kind of, I used to really like all that rock stuff. And being from up in, going to high school in Lismore and being on the North Coast, there was actually a pretty vibing music scene up there at the time. Like bands like Grinspoon and all that were all at uni there. And it was just like in Lismore town, there was a huge scene. So I remember when I was in year 12, we'd sneak out and sneak into bars to watch bands. And I remember seeing Grinspoon and stuff like that. So I'd always be learning all those kinds of lines. Mm. I do remember the day that my teacher showed me a recording of Victor Wooten,
mm-hmm.
and it was just, he just put on the CD and he was like, oh, that's a bass. And I was like,
nah,
man.
<It's funny.
laughs> that's not a bass. And he's like, nah, it is. And then I guess I kind of went pretty heavy into that stuff because I was just like, holy shit.
Yep.
Like how do you do that?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and I guess like you just start doing more and more reading and you kind of start hearing all these other names and guys like Marcus Miller and Stanley Clark and Jaco and all those guys that people are the heroes.
Yep.
I didn't really get into them at that time so much. I don't know why.
Mm.
Probably because I didn't practice enough.
And that shit can scare you too, eh? You can take it two ways. It can make you go and practice harder or just put your bass away.
It certainly does.
Yeah, yeah. Now, when are your sort of early memories of first gigs, like paid gigs and stuff like that?
Yeah, I think the first paid gig I did was in a place called Casino, which is like – west of Lismore on the north coast. And that was a guy in a local music shop that I'd kind of come to know just from being like a local kid that liked to hang out in music shops.
Yeah.
He had a gig and he couldn't do it. And he was like, you'd definitely be able to do this gig. Mm-hmm. So I think I was in year 12. Maybe I'd just finished school or something like that. It was pretty much just like pub rock. And I remember doing the gig and getting paid $150 cash at the end of it and thinking that was pretty amazing because it was paying me a lot more money than my job in the deli at Woolies did, at Franklin Snow.
Oh, we all got to do it though, eh?
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you remember the feeling of being on stage and playing that music though? Let's just put the money aside for a sec.
Yeah, I do. I mean, I definitely performed a lot through high school and stuff with different bands as well. Yeah. So I kind of knew like that wasn't so new to me.
Okay.
In terms of like being on stage. I guess the thing that was new is that I didn't know anyone else in the band and I kind of just rocked up as this kid.
Right. And like your first session almost.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
I had a book of charts that the other bass player had kind of written. And he kind of gave to me, so I had them. And it was like paper charts and a folder on a music stand. Like this is a long time ago. iPads. So I think, I mean, I'd practice the songs a heap, and I kind of felt like if there was a chart in front of me, I wasn't really worried about not knowing the songs. It was just trying to see what happened. Mm. I didn't really know anything about. I guess the stuff that you learn, the more that you do it in terms of like how to lock in with a drummer and like how to listen to everyone and how to play as a band. I definitely wouldn't have been aware of all that kind of stuff.
Yep.
I was probably just hacking away through these songs. But
yeah.
I mean, they seemed happy and I ended up filling in with that band a couple of other times, which is funny to think back to now. I hadn't thought about it in that years.
That's the whole point of this. Tickle the memories. All right. So where to from there? How we start to progress?
Yeah. So I guess straight out of high school, I went straight into uni. Okay. Did a music degree up in Lismore at Southern Cross.
I was going to say, is it still up there? Yep.
Yeah. I didn't want to go there because I'd kind of spent so much time in the area. But the uni I wanted to go to in Brisbane, I went and auditioned and what seemed super positive at the end of the audition ended up, I didn't end up getting offered a place there, but I'd come to meet the guy who was the lecturer, the bass tutor at Southern Cross through my high school, my private bass teacher who was actually at Southern Cross learning at the time. So I'd kind of been to his exams and I'd kind of been to the uni and I'd met the bass lecturer there a few times. So he actually called me out of the blue. I think after the first round of uni offers came out and I didn't get a place in Brisbane, he kind of called me and said, hey, I just saw that you didn't get into the Brisbane place you wanted to. Just wanted to let you know that there's a place here for you if you want it. And I kind of, at the time, I kind of had my heart set on moving away from home and just experiencing something different. So I kind of told him that we'll see what happens in the next round. And the next round of offers come out and I didn't get one of those. So he called me again and he's like, look, I'll give you the phone number of the guy who is the head of the music program up in Brisbane. Give him a call and I think that they're friends or something like that. He's like, give him a call and tell him that you got the number from me and that you audition and everything and just ask where they're at and if they're still places. Mm-hmm. Which was an amazing thing for him to do. That's totally above and beyond him, his job So I ended up doing that and the guy kind of said that they'd fill all the places. So I called, his name's Greg Lyon, who's the bass teacher at Southern Cross. He was, I called him back and I was like, cool, look, what do I have to do? And he said, just change your preferences in the uni admissions thing. And then I ended up going in for just to kind of meet him face to face. I didn't really have to audition or anything like that, which I found out later was rare because I think the audition process was pretty stringent, but I think he was pretty keen on having like a local kid kind of hang around and come in. So I went straight from high school to the music program up there, which is just like the biggest eye-opening experience musically that I could have had.
In what way?
Yeah. Well, just in terms of like, well, I guess in my year, there were four bass players, and there was like 25 guitarists and 16 drummers and 20 singers, and everyone has to do performances at the end of every semester and they need a bass player. So it just meant that I was rehearsing and playing all the time.
Yeah.
So you just get so used to playing so many different types of music with so many different people. And you kind of get good at rehearsing and learning stuff, and it's just playing and being exposed to so much of the music. So much music that I'd never been exposed to as an 18-year-old kid from Northern New South Wales. There's obviously just so much stuff that you don't know. And I was also, there weren't too many people that were my age there. Like most of the people were kind of well into their 20s and even in their 30s some of the time. So I'm kind of hanging out with all these different people who had actually been in the music industry and been doing gigs for years and had, for whatever reason, decided to go and study music. So that was pretty cool as well.
Mm. All right, so uni finishes. Did that sort of open your eyes and make you think, maybe I'm only going to get so far up here? Do I need to move to a city?
Yeah, totally. I think,
okay.
I mean, I was definitely ready to move by that stage. I'd kind of been on I think I was 21 or 22.
Okay.
By that stage. So I'd kind of been around that area for 20 years.
Yeah.
For as long as I could remember anyway.
Yeah. Yep.
So it was definitely time to try something new. And a lot of the people I studied with moved to Melbourne, and for whatever reason, I didn't want to do that.
Do you remember why? Do you remember why you didn't want to go to Melbourne?
Not really.
Okay.
No idea. Yeah. It might have had something to do with just like, I don't know, like meeting different people instead of kind of just like moving where I already knew everyone. I honestly don't. I can't remember.
Okay. All right.
But I remember speaking to Greg, and he said, oh, you're going to move to Sydney. Here's a couple of phone numbers for some guys. Just give him a call and tell him that you got the number from me and catch up for a beer. You'll get along with both of them. There were two bass players that had both gone through Southern Cross. Mm-hmm. One was James Hazelwood, and the other one was a guy named Pat Savina. And they're both such legends. And yeah, it was awesome. Like I think Greg said something like, "Oh, they're both country boys as well. Like you guys will get along really well."
Right.
So I moved to Sydney, and then it probably took me like 6 months or so, and then I ended up calling him and catching up and having a beer and just kind of talking about what it's like, which was awesome. It's awesome to have that kind of that network just, that I could kind of just fall into and just. Yeah. And then like James, like to this day, I think Pat lives in Western Australia now, in Perth, and he's still gigging over there. But James has played with everyone. He's such a monstrous bass player.
Yep.
But to this day, I still get calls from people, that James has given my number to, to fill in for him, or he can't do it. So he's, for whatever reason, they need a bass player, he can't do it. It's so lovely that happens, especially from a guy like that. He's such a weapon and such a genuinely lovely dude.
That's great. Now, what year I'm just trying to think of trying to see the time. What year did you come down to Sydney?
I think it was 2005.
Okay.
Yeah, around 2005 or 2006. Yeah, or kind of, I think it's 2005. So I moved down to Sydney. I got a job working in a music shop just because I need a job. Mm-hmm. And then I was doing that for a while. And then one of the, it's funny, I can trace pretty much all of the gigs that I do now back to one gig.
Really?
It's pretty wild when I think about it like that. But there was one of the guitar tutors in that music shop was a guy named James Kelly. And he kind of just came in one day. He's like, "Hey man, I'm doing this gig on Friday. Do you want to do it?" And I was just like, "Yeah, cool, sure." And it was in Balmain at the Town Hall Hotel.
Yep.
Yeah, it was there, and it was just band, like a 7-piece band, just playing like funk and reggae and that kind of stuff. And then from that, I started getting like the keyboard player called me, and I did some gigs with him. And then the singer called me, and I started doing some more stuff with him. And then it's wild how it
just goes.
Yeah.
So James Kelly, is that not Jim Kelly?
That's a different guy.
Okay, right. Okay.
Yeah.
I just needed to clarify that.
Yeah, it's also even more hilarious because James, who also gets called Jim, yep, went to Southern Cross and learned guitar from Jim Kelly. So Jim Kelly's.
It's a fucking strange world sometimes, eh?
Yeah. Yeah, I was kind of like, oh, this is so wild.
Yeah, yeah.
And there's like, I think Carlos Adura was playing drums.
Yep.
Sam Boyd was playing keys. I can't remember who the horn players were. Jim was playing guitar. I think the singer was a guy named Sid. And it kind of all ended up just kind of spreading from there.
Yeah. Now the music shop gig, was that the gig at the Bass People, or did that come about?
No, that came later. So I worked in a music shop in Willoughby called Music City. I was there for probably 4 years. Mm-hmm. And then I don't know how I kind of came across the ad, but there was an ad looking for people for a bass specialty store that was going to open up. And I was kind of like, well, I kind of know how to work in a music shop, and I'm a bass player, and that probably sounds a bit more fun than what I was doing. I applied for that and ended up being given the job of the manager.
Oh, just like that.
Yeah. That was, they were like, do you want to be the manager? I'm like, I don't know how to do that, but sure. And I ended up doing that, which is awesome. And there's still relationships that I have to this day of people that I've met when I was running that shop, both people like other players and stuff like that. Right. And also like companies, like the companies that I've got endorsement deals with now, I met a lot of those guys through running that music shop.
Yep.
So it's kind of it's interesting how it all ends up working out together. But yeah, so that was the end of 2007 was when December 2007 was when we kind of first opened the doors, mm-hmm. And that kind of went all the way to 2012.
I walked into that store in 2008. And I wanted to buy a Galien Kruger amp.
Yeah.
And you talked me into I ended up walking out with a little Mark II.
And a
Mark Bass 410 quad, with the front ports.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because I always loved that Galien Kruger flea sort of sound, and it's a sound that I kind of grew up with too, like back in New Zealand. Yeah. A lot of the bass players had that gear. And yeah, I just had that sound in my head. And then when I walked into the shop, you said, "Oh, have you heard of this stuff? Listen to this. You know, this is what the Galien Kruger stuff can do, but listen to this." And there's a there was a couple of filters on the little mark. You went, look, it could sound like this, like poof, you know? And I went, fuck, it looks cool too. It's orange and black, you know?
And it's light.
So that was it. Yeah.
Yeah, wow. Oh, wow.
Yeah,
there's another connection I didn't even know.
Another connection.
Yeah.
So you said that sort of, I mean, that sadly closed in 2012. Can you talk about how that sort of came about closing? Was it things like sort of people buying stuff online? Alan's.
I mean, we used to import a lot of stuff, so we were kind of pretty savvy to the reality of buying stuff online, especially because there were a few years in there where the Australian dollar was over parity with the US, so it was like buying stuff in the US was so cheap. So we kind of always had maintained a pretty decent online presence. It was more that the guy who owned it, he set that shop up because he kind of had a dream to own a bass specialty store that was like a really high-end hi-fi store. And so he was, I guess he was kind of just ticking a thing off his bucket list.
Okay.
And it got to the point where he'd done that and I could kind of tell something was going to change. I was probably getting a little bit, I don't know what the phrase is. You kind of get like itchy feet or something like that. I needed something to change, and I could feel that something was going to change anyway.
Okay.
And he'd just been overseas. He came back and him and I had a meeting, and he kind of told me that he wanted to get out of it. And he said that he offered to sell it to me.
Mm-hmm.
And I kind of knew straight away that I didn't want to do that. I think if I had been 10 years old, I think I was 28 at the time. I think if I had been 10 years older, I probably would have said yes and changed it. But I kind of hadn't ever, since I'd been in Sydney, I'd always kind of had a job. I had never tried to give it a crack.
So you weren't a pro muso at that stage.
Yeah. I was still, I mean, I was gigging, but I kind of always had this day job. And so I hadn't really done much touring or anything, and just stuff that I wanted to do. Which I knew that I would regret if I didn't at least give it a crack.
And was the store successful when it was like at the time that he came in to sell it or offer it to you? Was it still doing really well?
Yeah, it was doing okay.
Yep.
I guess the thing that it needed to, like, some changes needed to be made to really get it kicking ass.
Okay.
And that's, I guess I knew what those changes would be.
Yep.
And I just wasn't prepared to do that work at the time. And he obviously had some other plans for what he wanted to spend his time and his money on, because it was ultimately all his money that I would spend every month buying all these guitars and amps.
Right.
So it seemed like, it seemed like he could try and sell it as a business, or he would just run it down and slowly kind of just move the stock out until it was at a point where it wasn't really worthwhile having the doors open anymore. So over that next year, it kind of went from we had three shop fronts on Parramatta Road. Mm. We kind of went from three down to just one in the end. And as we'd kind of sell more stock, we'd kind of realize that, cool, we can fit three shops into two now. And then by the end, it was just, there was one left. And I think for the last like 7 months, it was just me in there every day.
Right.
Which got a bit lonely, but I got lots of practice done.
Oh, that's cool. That's cool. Sussing out all the gear as well. That's great.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay, and then finished.
Yeah. Mm. So as soon as the shop finished, I mean, obviously you knew it was coming. Were you setting yourself up at that stage to go pro? Did you have some gigs lined up and were you putting yourself out there to be available a lot more?
Yeah. Well, there were lots of people that I was kind of already working with.
Yep.
like quite a bit, and they all kind of knew what was happening, and they also knew that I was probably a lot more available and a lot more flexible in terms of being able to be away and all that kind of stuff because of the what was happening with the shop. Even in those last few months, the owner of the shop was kind of, he was cool. He's like, if you need to go away or something, just like, just arrange for one of the other guys to just come in and open and run the shop for that day. That's cool. Like, so yeah, I guess by the time that the doors actually closed, I had gigs in the book and everyone kind of knew, well, other people that I knew that I worked with regularly knew that I was going to be around a bit more. Yeah. And then it kind of just went from there. I think like a month later or something, I got offered a tour with a blues artist, which was kind of went around the country and just bits and pieces like that. Yeah, and you just kind of, I don't know, just figured it out. If I had
$2 in my wallet. Hey, I hope you're enjoying this episode of the podcast. As you know, the Gig Life podcast is free. You don't have to pay anything ever. But if you find the value in the Gig Life podcast, you can donate or leave a tip. Go to thegiglifepodcast.com, click on that donate button, and give as little or as much as you like, and just know that anything you give will go back into creating great content for this podcast. All right, back to the episode. Rayman 3.
Yeah.
When did that come about?
So that was, I started filling in for Byron, who was the original bass player in that band.
Yep.
I started depping for him. I can't remember what year it was, probably like 2012, sometime around there.
Because he was the original voice bass player, wasn't he? Did he play the first? I think he played.
Yeah, he did the first couple of seasons. Yeah, and then he got, so he was doing the Rayman thing, and then he got the John Butler gig, and then he just ended up. That was all pretty all consuming. So,
yeah,
I'd been filling in up until that point, and then Ray just kind of asked me if I just wanted to do all the gigs.
That's cool.
Yeah, which I definitely wanted to because it's so much fun.
And how long did you do that for?
Well, still, whenever Ray lives in Berlin now, has done for the last probably like four or five years.
Okay, so whenever he's back or whenever he's got something going on.
Yeah, so he kind of comes back. It's kind of been once a year. Cool. He comes back once a year and he flicks us a message about a couple of months out when he's kind of planning it and he just says, what do you reckon, fellas? And we're always just so keen to just get together and have a play. It's just, there's like the thing with that band is it's just always been just so playful. Like there's so much interaction with the band and playing in a trio as well. I remember like one of the first gigs I did, was I think in Armadale or something. It was part of a tour, with Ray and Grant Geraghty was playing drums, and it was just like you start playing and then you just, it took me a while to get used to the space because that band was pretty, was not afraid to not play. Like there's oftentimes there would be no one, like it'd just be like a kick drum every couple of beats, you'd break things right down to nothing and jam. So I remember getting used to, I remember definitely noticing that there was so much space and then learning to not feel the need to put anything there, which was, it just made it so much more fun once you kind of get past that urge of just going, oh shit, nothing's happening. Maybe I'll do something stupid and play too many notes. You start playing with each other and it just becomes so much fun. And those gigs were always just, and they still are, just most of the time it's just us laughing and playing around. And there's so many little things that happen, or someone will do something and you'll decide to go with that, and then the song will go in this whole other different direction, and and then somehow it'll end up back where you started and stuff like that. It's so so great, so much musicality.
Yeah, you're talking about, you know, dealing with that space, and that I'm sure that sort of would have got ingrained in you. I've been listening to your Tenderfoot albums the last couple of days. Not saying there's that much space in that music. I mean, with the ballads, maybe there is, but like you're playing on that stuff. It's not busy. It's to the song. You could, if you want to, play so much more.
Yeah, for sure.
And then when you do your embellishments or your fills, they're really, really tasty, but then you're just back and it's just solid and it's simple. And, do you think, you know, the time in the band with Ray, like sort of knowing how to deal with that space has sort of taught you to approach songs like that?
Man, yeah. Definitely. Mm. Yeah, totally. Yeah. 100%. Like the all that stuff with Ray and even like stuff like back when I was back at uni, like that you learn different things and you're very – like if you're playing too much, you very quickly – learn how to realize that you are just by reading the other band members.
Right.
Well, at least I did. I mean, I remember definitely a few times at uni where I would be playing and then you kind of realize that everyone else, like someone else in the band is kind of just like, no, man, like that's not it.
Right.
Like the drummer might be like digging in and going, no, man, this is where we're at or something like that. All those kind of lessons. But in terms of like, yeah, I mean, you kind of say, like you say with the Tenderfoot stuff, you could always play more, but like it's a bass line. I like playing bass lines.
Yeah. 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 Certainly a bass line player, if that makes sense to the people listening. Yeah. You really are like master at it almost, you know?
Yeah. It's kind of, it's one of those things you get told all the time. It's like that's how you work, right?
Right.
Like that's how you get a job as a bass player.
is to play
the bass. It sounds like a stupid thing to say when you say it like that, but there's a very specific role that instrument in my mind has in most situations.
In most situations, yeah.
And you have to make sure that you're kind of doing that before you can do anything else, like in terms of anything else, like more harmonically interesting or even like the embellishments and stuff like that. There's kind of none of that stuff means anything if you're not playing the bass line and taking care of business. You kind of,
that's it. Taking care of business. Beautiful.
Yeah. Like you do that and then you'll find that there's places where it might be appropriate, or you can step out every now and then and play something, and it makes sense in the music or it makes sense in the song. And then there's other times where you just definitely don't need to step out at all and do that, and you just sit on the groove and that's your job. And if I don't know, I find that probably the most fun part of playing bass is like when everything's really kind of hitting. And like the bass and the drums and the keys and the guitar are all just really locked in and on something. That's the best part of it. Like, that's kind of really what does it for me.
Mm. Just moving forward to the Lockie Doley group, which we did talk a little bit about before. Now, does that group allow you to? I mean, there's obviously not as much space in that band. Lockie is just an incredible organ player and takes up that space.
Yeah.
You know, with the organ and the vocals. You know, yourself and Jackie, you got a hell of a thing going on there.
Yeah.
it's pretty wicked. It's a pretty mean pocket. But do you in that band get that little bit more, I'm not going to say space, opportunity to play a little bit more?
Yeah, totally. And it almost, that band almost demands it. The way that I kind of hear it is that music and Lockie, like you see Lockie play, he's at 150% all the time. He just from the downbeat, he is on and going hard. So, yep. And I mean, Jackie's the same. Like,
yeah,
Jackie doesn't hold anything back. So,
yep.
When I played with them for the first time in that particular lineup, I just kind of realized very quickly that part of that gig was to take up that space, like Lockie's kind of doing his thing with the organ and the clav and obviously singing, and Jackie's doing his thing. And then there's this other area over here, which is for me to do stuff in. And that, yeah, I guess that's something that, like, learning how to still be appropriate and still make it groove and make it feel good, because you're still like, it's as far as I'm concerned, the best times in that band as well is when everything's really locked in and we're like the three of us are all firing and everyone's kind of smiling, and yeah, that's when the with the vibes peaking, that's the best part. It's but yeah, it definitely has a lot more freedom than a lot of gigs. And I think that it's actually not so different to the Rayman thing in that sense, because there's only three guys, there's not a whole heap of stuff taking up sonic area. Like, it's not like there's a big horn section and three guitars and all that kind of stuff. So there's still heaps of space for me to be myself in there. Same as with Ray, it's just about, for me, it's just about like choosing your spots and choosing your battles and just listening to what's happening. Like, there's so like monstrous musicians on stage that you get to play with and interact with. And that's where the music happens, right? Is where you get to play with each other and the shows will be, different things will happen on different nights and different songs and that kind of interaction. I guess that's just another extension of that. It's just in a power trio, a power rock trio.
Yeah. Let's go back to Tenderfoot. How did that come about? And talk a little bit about the music that you've done, and you guys also got to go to Abbey Road Studios and record.
Yeah, that was
talk
wild.
A little bit about that. Yeah.
So that band came out of working with the main singer and the main songwriter in that band is a guy named John Vella, who I think I started.
What a great voice! Sorry, he's got a magic voice.
Yeah,
I just hypnotized by his vocals listening to your stuff these last couple of
years. Yeah, he sounds like himself. He doesn't sound like anyone else. It's awesome. And I've been working with him since I think like 2009, when he was just writing and releasing songs under his own name. And it was pretty much the keyboard player, a guy named Anthony Donlan. His nickname is Torch. So we don't actually, everyone just calls him Torch. I still don't think I know where that nickname comes from.
I kind of got the feeling by your face there that you didn't really know where it came from, so I'm not going to ask.
I think I've been told, but I don't know. Anyway, and Grant Geraghty from Rayman 3 was playing with him, and he got me involved because John needed someone to play some bass on one of his albums, like his album that he was recording back in the day. So John called me and I went and played some bass on it and did a couple of gigs. And then it kind of just started from there. I started playing in his band. I think he released that album and maybe like another EP. And then John took a bit of a break and he came back and said, look, I'm keen to do some more stuff again, but I don't want to do it just as me. I want to do it as a band. And we were all super keen. John had some new songs to kind of start working on. And then that's kind of how Tenderfoot came about. And we did an EP We did an EP that we recorded at Oceanic Studios, which is up in on the northern beaches there. It's Jim Mogini's studio from Midnight Oil. Mm-hmm. And we recorded an EP there. And then off the back of that, a few years later, John, aside from doing the band stuff, he is a composer, so he writes music for like ads and like film scores and stuff like that. And there's a library music company called Audio Network that he was writing some music for, and they heard the EP and they were like, can we put this in the library? Like, we want to have this music in our thing. And at the time we were we're a little bit reluctant to do that because we were kind of talking to some managers and there were some very kind of early discussions with some labels and stuff like that. So we were not so keen on that at that time. And then they were like, cool, that's cool. What do you guys think about doing another album? And what do you think about like maybe hearing some string arrangements and stuff on top? And what do you think about recording them at Abbey Road? And we kind of just went, yeah, wow. Because Audio Network are, they're a worldwide company now, but they started in London. So I think the guy who originally started Audio Network has got some strong ties to Abbey Road. I think he had a lot to do with it, saving it from actually getting knocked down and turned into apartments or something like that when that was on the cards a few years ago. So they do a lot of work there, and that's so they were like, yeah, we'd love to record it. And we recorded Abbey Road. We worked there all the time, and we kind of thought we'd be a bit cheeky and went back to them and say, how about we do the whole album there? which they promptly said no to. But they did say that they'd give us a full day at Abbey Road. And on that day, the strings needed to be done. The strings would only take 2 hours and we could have the rest of the day to do whatever we wanted there. So we all just decided that we were going to go to Abbey Road and finish the album. So we recorded most of the drums and bass were recorded here in Sydney at Hercules Street Studios. A guy named Ryan Miller, who we still work with today, mixed that first album. And also today I just heard a final mix of a new song that we just finished. Ryan's awesome. And great engineer, great mix engineer. Lovely dude as well. So we recorded that, most of the bass and drums here in Sydney. And then we went over to London and recorded the pianos all at Abbey Road using the same pianos that the Beatles used, which was just such a trip. Like there's one called the Chowlin and another one called Mrs. Mills. And it's just like you play them and you're like, holy shit, that sounds like the Beatles.
Wow, really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, like the torch just sat down and started playing Lady Madonna and you're like, holy shit, that's the piano that song was recorded on.
Wow.
Yeah. That whole day was just such an amazing experience. It was the way it ended up working out was I think I had a tour that was finishing in Sydney. I finished in Brisbane on the Saturday night, and then the day that we were given in the studio in Abbey Road was Monday in like London time. So there was one flight that would get me there on time and still let me be able to do the tour, which paid for my flight over there. So the other guys went over there like 3 days earlier and they were already there, and I landed in Sydney on the Sunday at like 9 a.m. and I think I flew out of Sydney on the same day at like 5 p.m. Right. Landed in London at I think 7 a.m. And yeah, it was just so surreal. It was like, well, I was waiting in the customs queue and I'm like, cool, all I need to do now is to get through customs. And the whole time I'd kind of been thinking like, well, what am I going to say? Like, I'm not here to play any gigs, but I'm going to a recording studio and like, maybe they're not going to believe me. And well, fuck, if they don't let me in, all this kind of stuff goes through your head.
Yeah.
So I get to the counter and the lady is kind of like, oh, cool, what are you doing here? And I just kind of took a deep breath and just said, oh, look, a band I'm in was signed to a publishing company over here and we're recording an album at Abbey Road and they're doing some recording today and I'm here to watch and to just to be there while it happens. And she kind of said, you came all this way just to do that? And I kind of said, well, it's Abbey Road. And then she kind of looked at me and looked at my passport and then went, yeah, fair enough.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, she stamped it. And then I kind of got through there and I was kind of standing there. I'm like, cool, now I need to figure out how to get to Abbey Road. Which ended up being fine. I think I caught a train and ended up just down the road and walked up. And you get there and the big gates are closed and there's all these people there just like standing at the gates and people are walking across the road and getting photos and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
So there's like people just standing at the gate. They're like two people deep. And I think I was probably stood there for about 10 minutes just at like outside with like, with a suitcase and like a bass. And I was like, oh, I should probably just go in, right? So you kind of ask people, oh, sorry, I just need to get through. People are just like, how come, why is he going inside? And I think I walked inside.
I'm with the band.
I walked inside and there's a guy there who just must be like, his job is to just guide people who have never been into Abbey Road before in and point them in the right direction. I walked in and he was like, hey. Hey man. He's like, oh, first time here. I was like, fuck, you can tell. And he's like, oh, you must be with the other Aussie boys, right? I was like, yeah. And he said, oh, they're downstairs at the moment having some brekkie. Just head down those stairs just there. So there's a down the stairs at Abbey Road. It's a huge place. Like it's a massive complex.
Is it really? Right.
But downstairs there's like a cafe during the day and then it gets to like 6 or 7 p.m. and it turns into a bar. Yeah, like they've got like beer taps and all that kind of stuff. But during the day it's just like so we sat down and we all had some breakfast and then we went upstairs and spent the day in Abbey Road. And I ended up retracking one of the bass things just because I was at Abbey Road and there was no way I wasn't going to not record
anything. Yeah, of course.
So we did that and we did all the pianos. There's actually one of the songs on the album. It's called Life's Not Perfect. That's actually recorded in the studio at Abbey Road with John just singing and playing. That was just, yeah, like we were just like, let's just do that. So like we were all kind of taking turns with the camera walking around and then so he's doing that and there was this like little mezzanine section that I was standing on above taking pictures and I didn't realize that you could actually hear the camera shutter. So
in the recording?
If you listen at the end of the song.
I'm gonna listen to it again.
Once he finishes, yeah. You can hear like a camera shutter, and that was me taking pictures. Right. it was just one of those things that like we listened back in the studio, and I was just like, "Oh man, I'm so sorry." And he's like, "Nah,
no, you're not. Cool. No, you recorded that at Abbey Road, man."
Yeah. So
did you get to see the those plate reverb rooms?
Yeah, so we around tour.
Oh, right, awesome. Awesome.
So the guy who had got us in there, the guy from Audio Network, who was the owner, I think we had a break, like a tea break or something like that. And he was like, "Oh, Joel, you went here the other day, so you didn't get the tour. Come with me now."
Awesome.
And he's just like, "Cool. So you're not allowed to you're not allowed to take your phone out or you're not allowed to take any photos, but I'll show you all this stuff. Yeah. And so we walk along the thing and there's like a recording console on the, just out in the hallway on wheels, this old console. And he's like, oh yeah, that was, I think Dark Side of the Moon or something was recorded on that, or some huge album. And I'm like, and it's just sitting in the hallway. He's like, yeah, everything still gets used. Then he opened this cupboard and there was this really old four track recorder. It was in two pieces. Two or three pieces. And he was like, the Beatles recorded their first album on that. And I was just like, holy shit.
Yeah.
And just like all that stuff is just around. And it all gets used still, and it's all in working order. And they all, like, they've got obviously like guys that maintain it and stuff like that.
Mm.
Like I think the desk that we were recording with in Studio C, which is the smallest one, which is what we're in, that was getting used the next day in one of the other studios. So they had to, like, we finished and then they said, all right, cool, let's move it. So they kind of got it on its wheels and moved it out into one of the other studios for the next day or something like that. So he showed me all the different studios in Studio A, which is the huge one that they do all the orchestra recordings in.
Mm.
They were doing a mic scratch test, setting up for an orchestra the next day. So there's like the guys in the control room and then one of the engineers just walking around scratching these mics to check the lines were all there.
Yep.
And then we stuck our head. There was some people in the Studio B, the middle one, which is where all the it's like the one that the Stones did that stuff at, and all that live, you know, that series Live at Abbey Road that was on TV.
Yep.
Yeah. All that stuff was in that middle sized one.
Okay.
So we got that tour, and then we finished, I think we finished at 9 PM, and then the engineer who was one of the house engineers at Abbey Road just kind of said, oh cool, let's go and have a beer. And we were like, oh cool. Yeah. Is there a pub? He's like, oh no, we just go downstairs. There's a bar downstairs. We walked downstairs and there was just, was like everyone who had been working in the facility was just hanging out there. It was packed.
Wow.
And just walked up. I think I walked up and bought a round of beers and just started talking to one of the guys there. And like a guy who was next to me at the bar, and he's like, oh, you were the Aussie guys in Studio C. Oh, cool. How was it? How's your experience, first experience at Abbey Road? And all that kind of stuff. And I said, oh, what were you doing? And he's like, oh, I work out of here. I was just mixing a song for Adele. It's just like, this is heavy. this is heavy company that we're have wandered into here. It was such a wild experience, and like we're so proud of how that album turned out. It's still so stoked. I think we actually released it 2 years ago now. And I listen to it now, and I'm just as happy now as I was when it came out.
Knowing that part of it had been recorded at Abbey Road, when I was listening to it, especially today, there's I can't remember the name of the song. There's a little trumpet part in it,
yeah.
And I don't know if it was just me subconsciously knowing that the Beatles were at Abbey Road, but I was kind of thinking, is that a little ode to the Beatles?
Yeah, totally.
Yeah,
there's a couple of the songs that ended up being fairly, like, I mean, I think we're definitely thinking of borrowing pretty heavily from the Beatles, just with the vibe and that kind of stuff.
Right.
But I know I can't remember the exact song.
The trumpets, it's not right up in the mix. Yeah, it's kind of back there, it's blowing there. Yeah, and you can hear the strings as well, and it's like,
yeah,
you know, see George Martin sitting there and something like that. That's cool, man. Well done. Yeah, and it's really, really great music. I really enjoy it. I've said this a number of times on the podcast. One of the coolest things I get from this podcast is I get to listen to a lot of different music. Like, so whoever I'm talking to, I'll, you know,
yeah, for sure,
track down their stuff, and I listen to it, and it introduces me to music that I probably would never have just sort of found on my own.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
And yeah, that's definitely a winner. So you got a new fan here. So awesome.
Thanks for it. I'll tell the boys.
Yeah, sweet as. All right, let's. I wanted to ask a few questions about the voice and that experience for you.
For sure.
I guess first up, how did it come about?
So I actually auditioned 2 years ago, and I didn't get it then. It was me and a guy named Christian Attard, who's beast of, I mean, you know, Christian, everyone knows Christian. Mm-hmm. So I didn't end up getting it at the time. But Christian did it for the last two seasons, and then I think he had some stuff going on back in LA, so he couldn't commit to the whole season or something like that. I think he had some stuff with his own band that he kind of had penciled in. So the MD, Scotty Applin, he called me and just kind of asked me if I'd be keen, if I was interested in doing it. And I was, definitely. Mm. It was one of those moments where, like, I was obviously disappointed that I didn't get it when I auditioned 2 years ago. But at the time, like, I walked out of the audition thinking I couldn't have done any better.
Okay.
And it also kind of kicked my ass to get a couple of other things happening, because it's a lot of that show, I mean, increasingly so, is a lot of it is played on synth bass. And there's also some upright stuff as well. I didn't own an upright. I hadn't played upright before, and I'd done like a tiny amount of synth stuff. One of the things is Christian plays synth great. And he also plays upright. So I was kind of like, cool. Well, this is a kick in the ass for me to actually put some work into those things. Not even kind of thinking like down the track, maybe I'll get another call or something. It's like, well,
I gotcha.
This is just one of those signs that you've not, like, I'd known for a long time that I should put some work into those things and I hadn't. So that was just me, I don't know, taking it as a sign from the universe to actually
time to buy some new tools for the toolbox.
Yeah, exactly.
Start using them.
And then it's so funny, like the next day, a really, really good mate of mine called me, and we were just talking. He's like, oh, by the way, do you know anyone who wants to buy an upright bass? And I'm like, yeah, me. And he's like, really? And I'm like, yeah. And he's like, oh, okay, well, do you want me to bring it around? And I'm like, yeah. So he, like, that afternoon he came around and left it with me, and awesome, ended up buying it. And that's kind of got a whole other level of sentimentality now, because that guy was a guy named Luke Liang who actually died a few years ago. So I feel kind of lucky I feel lucky to have known Luke, because he was such a beautiful guy. But to have that bass every time I play it now, it's kind of like a nice reminder. It makes me smile.
Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah,
that's cool. So when you started out, you know, at the start of the year, it was pre-COVID. When you did the blinds and the battles, you had crowds there.
Yeah.
Right. It must have been strange to kind of go back after your production break and not having crowds there, because it's kind of what the show's all about, really, isn't it?
Yeah, totally. You know? And especially because, like, it was my first season, but the other guys in the band, like Michael Dolce on guitar, Adam Sofo, Key, Scotty on keys and MD, they'd done it every season. So this was their ninth season. And Andy Andy Fissenden on drums. This was his second season. So they all kind of, they'd known what it was like, and they were kind of saying, oh yeah, this is how this works. And they'd kind of give me a heads up going into each round about what's different from the last round and how things change. And then they're like, and then we get to the lives at the end, and it's like everything is timed, and you kind of like it's a whole other level of excitement and I guess pressure. Mm. And then kind of when we went back in there, and even talking to them, they're just like, oh man, this is so weird to be doing like the live rounds, yeah, but not having an audience.
And having two of the judges on screen.
Yeah, I know. That was another thing that was kind of a little bit weird, but they ended up getting different Aussie like icons to come in, or Aussie artists to come in and be like a guest mentor each round.
Right.
Yeah. So I think like the Veronicas did one, Amy Shark did one, Daryl Braithwaite came in.
Yep.
So yeah, that was, like I said, ended up working. I mean, we got to play the horses with the guy who made the song famous.
Yeah, that's awesome.
That was,
because that was the one of the things I was going to ask was, you know, when you're doing those sessions with the artists, how's that done? Is like the judge basically FaceTiming it in?
Yeah,
and talking and
for those two, they were, yeah, like they had a satellite. They had a satellite hookup.
Right.
So they'd beam them in on the screen, and it was all real time interaction, and they'd kind of sing the song, and then they'd do it's called the mentoring sessions. Yeah, so it was the same setup as, I guess, when they filmed the live show. They'd satellite in and just be there, either in London or Los Angeles. Right. Yeah.
Right. Now playing live. Now, how was that pressure?
Yeah, you
know, playing live to TV. Sorry, I mean playing live to TV.
Yeah, it's different, especially. I mean, it's funny the way that the show works in terms of like the workload. So you start off with the blinds, and there's just so much music to play. It's kind of like a baptism of fire. You kind of go in with like 100 songs, and you're playing. You're getting sounds and learning and reading 100 songs. So I think in terms of the pressure, I was definitely nervous going into the first day on set, doing it, just kind of going, oh shit, like trying to make sure I had all my shit working and getting used to the setup of my little workstation that we had set up. But I think once I kind of got into a bit of a, like, you kind of get a couple under the belt, and then you're like, all right, cool. This is cool. I'm with this now. And then it's just a matter of like, I don't know, trying to forget that there's cameras there, but not forget, just kind of focus on nailing your part.
And millions of people watching.
Yeah. Well, there is that. I don't know. I consider myself pretty lucky that I'm generally a pretty level headed and laid back guy.
Yeah.
So I'm able to kind of talk myself out of nerves or kind of use, it's actually something that high school music teacher told me. We're doing a performance at the Opera House actually, and I was backstage, and I was obviously super nervous. It was my HSC performance. And he was like, look, I know you're nervous, but this is just another gig, and you just have to use those nerves as like, use that as your energy for the performance. And I've just always remembered that. So anytime I kind of get nervous, it's like, cool. I just kind of try and tell myself that I know how to do it. Like, you just like, I know how to play bass. I know how to do these songs.
Yeah. That's why you're there.
Yeah, it's that kind of thing. I think I read like an interview with Pino Palladino once, and he was talking about this thing called trust chops. He's like, at the end of the day, you just need to kind of let go and trust that you've done the work, and just let it kind of happen. So I try and remember that, and just try and, I don't know, just try and nail it and just and focus and do what I'm there for. I mean, the thing with playing in a band like that is everyone is really so great. Like, it's such a killer band.
Yeah.
And everyone is just so all over their stuff. Like mm-hmm. Dolce's all over all the guitar sounds and like mm-hmm. everyone's just taking care of their business. Mm-hmm. And I just think, cool, well, now I have to do the same because that's my job here is to take care of my part of this so we can all, so it all works together. And everyone in that band just does such a great job of that. They just nail it. And then you hear it back and you're just like, yeah, that sounds fucking great.
Yeah. Did you stuff up at all?
There are a couple of little things. Mm-hmm. Nothing major. Yep. I think the biggest thing was one of the songs I had the wrong patch on the synth. So I kind of started out with and it was like the sound that I had on there was like a subby thing and it needed to be like a bit more of like an envelopey gnarly thing. Okay. And I kind of realized and I was like, all right, cool. Looking at the chart and I'm like, I know exactly where it is that I'm going to press the button. So you kind of, yeah, I think I was like, all right, cool. There's like two beats before the first chorus or at the end of this section. So I think like the first four bars or something, I'm playing this subby sound and then I hit the note and then I hit the patch change and then I had the other sound and I was like, all right, cool. Now just don't fuck up anything else. It's one of those things that you kind of one of those lessons that you learn where like I remember learning very early on that you just have to live with your mistakes. Like there's nothing you can do to change them. So you can either let it ruin the rest of the song or the rest of the gig, or you can just forget about it and get on with it. Yeah. And that was definitely one of those moments where I was like, cool, let's just get on with it.
I spoke to a drummer on the podcast a while back and he had played some live TV. And there was a spot in the song. I think it was supposed to end on the end of four or something like that. And then the whole like the band stopped at the end of four, but he hit the one of the next bar. And like when you listen back to the TV, you don't notice it. But he said that everyone just went like looked at him, and it just it consumed him, and it messed him up for days. Eh? It just really cut him up.
Yeah, man, it totally
take it. You know, you can take it many ways, I suppose.
Yeah, it totally. Sounds like
you've got the other sort of attitude. Well, I mean, it's happened. Move on.
Yeah, and it's. Yeah. I mean, there's. I mean, thankfully that I'd done enough work in the lead up, especially for the blinds. It's probably the biggest thing, just because there's so much music, and you don't. As the rounds progress, you play the songs a lot more together as a band.
Right.
So you get a chance to kind of refine things a little bit more.
Yep.
But the blinds is kind of like you've got like 100 songs to get through and they're huge days and like you start early. I think everyone makes a mistake. Like there's always like a little thing where, someone will do something like this. It's like you just have a brain snap for like a split second and you come in like a little bit late on a note or something like that. But there's nothing that's ever really that horrific that happened that wasn't able to just be either like fixed or even not even noticed.
Yeah. Yeah. That's cool. Yeah. Are you doing it next year? Do you know?
I don't know. I don't know if it's going ahead just because we haven't. I mean, I expect that the band would be like one of the last groups to know. Well, maybe not the last, but like, you know what I mean? Like we'll get told if it's happening when it's happening. if it's going ahead and yeah, I'd definitely love to do it again. It was a great challenge and a great experience, and it was also just such a great hang. They're just such good dudes to hang out with, like so much fun. And even the times that someone does make like a little bit of a mistake, like everyone just gives each other shit for a little bit and then gets over it, because we all know that it happens to all of us. And yeah, it's a really fun hang. There's lots of laughs that happen.
Yeah. I noticed on your Facebook, you post a fair bit in regards to things like Support Act and some anxiety groups and stuff like that.
Yeah.
What's your thinking around that? Is that something that you deal with yourself and are sharing to other people? I say that, and I'm happy to say this, but anxiety is something that I've had to deal with all my life.
Yeah.
You know, severe anxiety. I mean, I've got it sussed now. I've got control of it and that kind of thing. But I know how debilitating it is. And when I saw that on your Facebook, it sort of piqued my interest.
Well, I guess, I guess I'm fortunate that I haven't ever suffered from really like severe anxiety or mental health issues like that, which I'm super grateful for. But my wife's a psychologist. So I guess a lot of the discussion, like there's a lot of talk at home. She's doing a PhD at the moment on the effect of social media on emerging adult minds. So like it's something that we talk about quite a lot at home. And it's also something that I'm really aware of that a lot of musicians suffer from. And I, for whatever help that it is, I think that if there's those resources around, then I'd like to be able to help people get them. In terms of the Support Act stuff, they do heaps of really great, like free stuff. Like during COVID, they had the lunchtime. I can't remember what they were called. Like every lunchtime, they'd have like a half an hour chat with someone. My wife did a heap of those actually. She's now doing a heap. Like there's like a monthly like a webinar thing that's free for anyone to sign up to, and it's just specifically talking about like different aspects of like how to deal with like unhelpful thoughts or how to sit with with difficult feelings and stuff like that. There's actually one on tomorrow, which won't matter when this goes to air, but it's at least for the next while, once a month, a Support Act, and it's free for people to join. So if that can help some people deal with some harder stuff or even just kind of like just maybe normalize it a little bit more. Because it's something that I think it's better now than it probably was in the past in terms of it there being less of a stigma about it, but a lot of people still won't talk about having if they're going through some problems. It could be anything, like it doesn't have to be like full out depression. It can be anything.
Totally.
But there's definitely, I think a lot of people might not feel comfortable talking about that. So I guess the reason I share it is because I think that it's great. And I think that those conversations are really useful to have. And if people can have access to those things that they might not have known about, then I think that that's even better, that if people can get those resources, and especially when they're so great and they're so free at the moment when everyone's kind of probably hurting for money, and that's adding this whole other layer of stress as well as all the other stuff going on at the moment. It's a rough time for a lot of people, and I know that a lot of my friends have had a pretty rough few months. So I try and share that stuff whenever I can, and hopefully people see it, and I just like people to to talk to each other. I'd rather not have what happened with Luke happen with any more of my friends.
Gotcha. Good stuff, man. Well said. Yeah. Well said. I'll link some of that stuff in the show notes of this episode.
Yeah.
So just open up your phone, people, and click on the links. And
And there's heaps of that stuff around. Like if people want to know where more of that stuff is, just send me a message on Facebook or something. Like even if we haven't met, I can point you in the right direction and that kind of stuff too.
You're a good man. Earlier today, I said I need you to choose one song, and that song is to be a song that's had probably the greatest or biggest impact on you. I've got the song queued up to play, so I want you to introduce the song, and then we'll talk a little bit about how it's had the impact on you, and then we'll listen to the song a little bit and we'll talk about it. And so if you can tell me what that
song is. The song is called Voodoo by the Neville Brothers.
Can you hear it? So where did you hear this, and what's that impact?
So when I was at when I first started uni, there was a thing that I don't know if they do it anymore, but it was in first year, they'd have first year camp, which was like I think like 2 months into first year of uni, all the first year students would go to this place in Lennox Head, and you'd stay there for 4 days, and all you do all day is You'd have different workshops. You'd get put into groups and go and do different workshops. So there'd be like a workshop with a guy named Greg Sheehan, who did a lot of the Odd Time and the Number Diamond stuff. He's a drummer, but also so much more than that. And then you'd go to a different workshop and it'd be on something else. But every night, part of what you would do every day is put yourself in bands, to play songs that night to everyone, to all the other students and the other staff. So the first night was all the lecturers got their different bands together and they'd all kind of get up. And the first night was just all the lecturers playing with each other. And I remember sitting there, I can still remember it so vividly. And my bass lecturer, Greg Lyon, it was his turn to play a couple of songs that he liked or that he wanted to play with his particular band, which was called the Hip Operation.
That's awesome.
Yeah. And so the first song they started playing was this. And I just remember it kind of like it starts with the drums, I think. It's
percussion.
Dave Sanders was playing drums, or Scott Hills, and it started. And then that bass line kicked in, and I was just like, "What the fuck is this music?" "What am I hearing? What is this?" And I just sat there for the whole song, and then the vote just started coming in, and it was like he was singing, and then I think one of the other lecturers was on backup, and I was just like, this is the coolest shit I've ever heard. It was just so swampy and funky, and yeah, it just it left a huge impact on me. And so the next week I got into my one-on-one tutorial with Greg, and he was kind of saying, oh, how'd you like the camp, and it was good fun and all that kind of stuff. I'm like, yeah, it was all good. Tell me about this. What was that song? he's like, what song? I was like, the first one. And he's like, oh. And he just started playing the bass line. I'm like, that one. Tell me everything about that. Then he's like, oh, that's the Neville Brothers. And so he introduced me to the Neville Brothers and the Meters. And that just blew the doors wide open for me in terms of just that kind of funky music. I'd kind of come in and he'd give me like each week or each every other week or something like that. He'd just give me a CD that he'd made. And he was like, I burned you a copy of this CD. And it would just be like mixes of all this kind of stuff and some like Little Feet and like Parliament and stuff. And then he actually gave me his CD copy of the Donny Hathaway live album.
Oh, man.
And this was kind of when, before it had been reprinted. So he was kind of like, don't dare fucking lose this. I haven't had a chance to burn it.
Yeah.
But you need to go and listen to this album. And I remember taking it to the library and burning a copy and then just like listening to it and just going, oh, man, it's like a lifetime of learning.
Yeah. Do you know Simon Olsen?
Yeah.
Yeah. Simon was my bass teacher for a little while.
Oh, cool.
And he introduced me to that Donny Hathaway live album.
Yeah, wow.
It was that and it was Lewis Johnson's playing on the Off the Wall album. There's a song and it starts off with slap because I said, oh, can you teach me some slap bass? And he played me one of the tracks off the wall.
The bass playing on so many of those Michael Jackson albums is
great. As is the drumming.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's just all really good stuff. You mentioned the Meters before. When I asked Jackie what his song was for this segment, it was a Meters song. Yeah.
I could have guessed that.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's a huge Meters fan.
Yeah.
I guess that's the playing in Lockie's thing, there's definitely space for it to go down that path as well. Like, because Lockie's all over all that kind of funky keyboard stuff too.
Mm.
So there's definitely times where we've just in the middle of a song broken into a Meters song and just jammed out on that for a while.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah. Yeah, that music is that. Like for a long time, I didn't really want to listen to anything else but that. There was a compilation. It was on Soul Jazz Records. It was just called New Orleans Funk, and I think there's three volumes of it. But the first one was a CD in the library at uni. I remember borrowing that, and that had some killer stuff on it too, like Lee Dorsey and stuff like that. I think all that stuff's on Spotify now as well. But like just all that kind of music, and so that Neville Brothers song was like the doorway for me to get into all of that kind of stuff. And a lot of the gigs that I did when I first moved to Sydney were playing a lot of that kind of music. Like,
right?
Yeah, like we'd play at the Mac. Before, like this was before they did the reno, and the bar used to stick right out. Mm-hmm. The front, so yeah, like there'd be some weeks like we'd be playing there three times a week and just like playing all that kind of stuff, and yeah, it's so much fun.
That's the first time I saw Byron play, was at the Mac.
Yeah, I believe that.
Yeah, and he was just sitting, he had his it was just a single 12, I think, and he was sitting on that, and he had his head sitting to the side of that, and he had a little synth there.
Oh, yeah.
And he had his bass. And, like, it seemed like he just wasn't interested in being there, but it was one of the most phenomenal bottom-ended performances I've ever seen. It's just incredible.
Oh, man, he's a badass. He's such a beast.
Yeah.
He's one of my favorite bass players.
Yeah, awesome.
So creative. Like, the way he plays, like he'll play things in a way that I guess like one of the things that I like so much is that the way he would play something is probably really different to the way I might approach it. Or just like maybe the same thing coming from a different angle that I hadn't thought of, but I kind of hear it and I'm just like, oh, fuck yeah, that's great.
Right.
And then obviously like learning all his lines from that first Rain Man 3 album, there's so much tasty stuff in there.
Mm. Very cool.
Yeah.
Joel Burton, it's been an absolute pleasure.
Oh, man.
Sitting and chatting with you tonight. Like I said, I wish we were sitting in front of each other right here. We'll have to do that another time over a beer,
yeah.
I think.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, definitely.
Awesome, man.
No worries, man. Look after yourself. If I don't see you beforehand, good luck with the baby. You're going to enjoy that journey because it's a hell of a journey, man. it's the best.
Thanks, brother.
No worries.
And, yeah, man. Thanks for having me. It's awesome to hang, and I love hearing the different interviews as well. It's funny. Like there's guys that I've known since I've moved in town moved to Sydney, and then I like listen to these podcasts that you've done with them, and you just kind of like, oh man, I didn't know that. I didn't know that.
I love it, man. Yeah, I love it. Thanks so much.
No worries, bro. Keep it up.
Sweet as, and we'll catch up soon.
Yeah, cool, brother. Talk soon.
All right. Later, bro.
There was nothing I could say to you that would let me through to the place I long to be behind your walls, just you and me. With nothing in between us, my definition of free. Think I scared you off the day we met, just hadn't happened yet. But it soon would, and then you would surely let me go, for fear of hurting me so. Much like all the ones before, they wanted more than they should ever ask for. Pretty lady with jewelry eyes, but I ain't no jeweler, and I ain't got no idea the price. Pretty lady, like a smokescreen from the fire, I know it's back then, but I'd rather burn than hide. So I pack my bags and I'll sit right here, ready to leave at a moment's notice, yet always hoping that you ask me to stay, never stray. Don't wanna go back where I was before. Pretty lady with jewelry eyes, yeah, I'd buy them, whatever the price. Pretty lady, like a smokescreen from a fire, but it's time to kiss this flame. Good night.